الحمد لله، نحمده سبحانه ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه، ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهدي الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وصفوته من خلقه وحبيبه، قد بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وكشف الغمة وجاهد في سبيل دينه حتى أتاه اليقين. فاللهم اجزه عنا وعن والدينا وعن الإسلام والمسلمين خير ما جازيت به نبيا عن قومه ورسولا عن أمته. اللهم أحينا على ملته وأمتنا على شرعته، واحشرنا معه على حوضه الكريم، واسقنا من يده شربة هنيئة لا نظمأ بعدها أبدا. اللهم آمين. We've been addressing the issue of the Quran before the beginning of Ramadan, and we'll continue to address this issue until we cover as much of it as we can. Today we are continuing to tackle the issue of the objectives of the Quran. Why did Allah send the Quran? What does Allah want us to learn from the Quran? And what does He give in the Quran that was not given before? And why is the Quran full of certain type of ayat and certain type of issues? To begin, the Quran, as we mentioned before, is a book first about Allah. Second, about Allah's creation with a focus on humans. The Quran is a book about Allah, then it is about and to all of His creation, and the third is the focus is on humans, us, the people. So the Quran starts off with the praise of Allah. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. In the name of Allah, the Merciful, the Compassionate. So it is in His name and it is about Him. So the beginning again is Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. All praise is due to Allah. What is the difference between Alhamd and Ash-Shukr? We know the hadith. Ibn Abbas says, مَنْ لَمْ يَشْكُرِ النَّاسِ لَمْ يَشْكُرِ اللَّهِ. الشكر is more limited than الحمد. الشكر is the response to a specific gift. So you find Prophet Sulaiman عليه السلام, he says, when he heard the ant talking to its community, he says, هذا من فضل ربي. This is part of the blessings of Allah upon me. ليبلوني أشكر أم أكفر. To test me whether I will be grateful or I will deny His gift. So the shukr is for a specific gift. And it is about the gift. But alhamd is about the giver. Alhamd is a praise of the person, a praise for the qualities the person stands for. So you read in the Quran, part of the qualities of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَؤُوفٌ رَحِيمٌ. This is a commendation of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Allah is praising the Prophet for being sallallahu alaihi wasallam, for being merciful and kind to the believers, right? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose for us a prophet that is the last prophet of all prophets. What's his name? Muhammad. One who is full of mahamid. Ahmad. Ashaddu an-nasi hamdan lillah. He is the one who is most praiseful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Mahmood, the one who is also praised by others who know him. مصطفى اصطفاه الله سبحانه وتعالى. Allah has chosen him. And in his commendation of the manners of the Prophet, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَى خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. Allah tells the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, indeed, you have great manners. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So when we start off in the Quran, we start off with, in the name of Allah, the merciful, the compassionate, Alhamdulillah. And when we say Alhamdulillah, Allah responds to us. Al-Fatiha is a two-way communication. I want to repeat this. Al-Fatiha is a two-way communication. When you read it, you need to know what Allah's response is to what you're saying. So the Prophet explains this to us. He says, فَإِذَا قَالَ الْعَبْدُ أَلْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ قَالَ اللَّهُ حَمَدَنِي عَبْدِي. When you say Alhamdulillah, Allah acknowledges your praise of Him, that all the hamd is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you say Rabbil Alameen, Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, Allah says, my abd majjadani abdi. My abd glorified me, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, afna alayya abdi. My abd hailed my praise upon me, subhanallah. Does he need our praise? Does he need our hamd? Does he need our thanks? We need it, but he is responding to every word you say to him to show you that he is here, he is listening, and he is paying attention. Not only that, but he is responding and he is praising you. In the hadith Qudsi, من ذكرني في ملأ من ذكرني في نفسه ذكرته في نفسي ومن ذكرني في ملأ ذكرته في ملأ خير من ملأه ومن أتاني مشيا أتيته هرولة. سبحان الله. Anyone who mentions me in his own self, I mention him in myself, Allah says. And if he mentions me in a group, I would mention him in a gathering better than his gathering. And he who comes to me walking, I, Allah says, come to him running. Subhanallah. He is trying. He is trying to endear us to him. He is trying to make us love him. He doesn't need our love, but because he knows in his divine knowledge and wisdom, if we know him, we are more likely to be saved, and he likes to save us. Allah doesn't want to torment anybody. مَا يَفْعَلُ اللَّهُ بِعَذَابِكُمْ إِن شَكَرْتُمْ وَآمَنْتُمْ. What would Allah do with your torment if you are grateful and believe? What would he do with this? It means nothing for him. It means nothing for him. In the hadith Qudsi, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that if you all, jinn and humans, from beginning of life till the end of life, got together and become the most righteous of hearts of you, all of you, this would not increase my dominion a bit. Nothing. And if you got together and you all became the worst of hearts amongst you, and the worst of servants to me, and the most disobedient of all, it doesn't decrease my dominion a bit. Nothing. And if you all ask me everything you want and more, and I give you all what you need and more, it wouldn't decrease my ownership, my kingdom, more than a needle that is dipped in an ocean. Allah. Say la ilaha illallah. This is Allah. He's telling us how much it means for him that we love him, and how insignificant we are compared to the dominion and the kingdom he has created. Why? Because he wants us to appreciate him. And he blames those who do not appreciate him. وَمَا قَدَرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدْرِهِ. They have not really appreciated Allah the way he ought to be appreciated. So the whole issue about the Quran being about Allah, about the word Allah being mentioned in the Quran more than 1800 times. The most repeated word in the Quran is Allah. Allah. In the proper name, Allah. Let alone in his other holy names and holy attributes. So Allah wants us to know him. To know him for what? To know him for the merciful one he is, the compassionate one he is, the caring one that he is. And to know that he is our Lord. He is the one who cares for us. وَهُوَ الَّذِي يَكْلَأُكُمْ بِاللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ قُلْ مَنْ يَكْلَأُكُمْ بِاللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ مِنَ الرَّحْمَانِ. Who takes care of you by day time and by night time? Who protects you from him? اللَّهُ يَتَوَفَّى الْأَنفُسَ حِينَ مَوْتِهَا وَالَّتِي لَمْ تَمُتْ فِي مَنَامِهَا فَيُمْسِكُ الَّتِي قَضَى عَلَيْهَا الْكِتَابِ ويرسل الأخرى قضى عليها الموت ويرسل الأخرى إلى أجل مسمى. When we go to bed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have taken all of our souls all at once. But what he does is, some of us will go to bed and they think they are sleepy and they are taken out and they do not wake up. Have you heard about people dying when they are asleep? Of course. So, وَيُرْسِلُ الْأُخْرَى. The others, that still their term is not over yet, he would send their souls back into their body, because the soul is what makes you the human being you are. When the spirit is blown into us, when we are being created in the wombs of our mothers, when the spirit is blown into us, then we have a soul. And this soul continues to grow and mature to make better decisions. The soul is what makes choices and helps us keep up with the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the soul is what balances and decides whether to take risk or not to take risk. So an-nafs is the centerpiece. So Allah يَتَوَفَّى الْأَنفُسَ حين موتها. When the term is over, Allah will take this nafs out. How does he take it? By taking out our spirit. When the spirit is out, الروح, the nafs dies, it's finished. So there is no nafs without the spirit, without the ruh. And then when he decides that our term is not over, then he sends back our souls into our body, and we wake up and we become active. Subhanallah. And that's why Muslim scholars, they call sleeping as the smaller death. Al-mawtatu sughra. So every night, we come almost to the verge of death. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us another chance. Here is your soul back into your body. Let us see what you do with your day. Let us see what you do with your life. Let us see how much better you are today than yesterday and the week before and the year before. And then he gives us stations to mark our progress. 5-time daily prayers, weekly Friday prayers, a month of fasting every year, the month of Ramadan, and other remarkable days in our life to make us remember him. And remember his book, and remember his guidance. So this book is about Allah, and mostly it's about us and our relationship with Allah. But what does Allah reward us most about? What is the best reward? The best reward is when Allah loves you. Because when he loves you, your life is different. Your heart feels different. The quality of your life is different. In the hadith Qudsi, وَلَا يَزَالُ عَبْدِي يَتَقَرَّبُ إِلَيَّ بِالنَّوَافِلْ حَتَّى أُحِبَّهُ. My servant continues to try to get closer to me by voluntary worship, voluntary acts of charity, voluntary acts of goodness and righteousness. Hatta uhibba, until I love him. Once I love him, I become the hearing with which he hears, the sight with which he sees, the legs on which he walks, and the hands with which he punishes. And if he asks me, I will certainly give him. If he seeks my support, I will certainly support him. Amazing. How much do we want from Allah to love him back? يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مَنْ يَرْتَدَّ مِنْكُمْ عَنْ دِينِهِ فَسَوْفَ يَأْتِ اللَّهُ بِقَوْمٍ يُحِبُّهُمْ وَيُحِبُّونَهُ. O you who believe, if you turn away from your faith, Allah will bring a community or a people that he loves and they love him back. So everything starts with his love. It is because of his love that he created the heavens and the earth and made them hospitable to us, easy for us. هو الذي جعل لكم الأرض ذلولا فامشوا في مناكبها وكلوا من رزقه وإليه النشور. It is he who has made this earth easy to walk on, easy to live on. From it we come, to it we go back, and from it Allah will bring us back again. منها خلقناكم وفيها نعيدكم ومنها نخرجكم تارة أخرى. Why was this difficult for people to understand, and why is it still difficult? There are lots, millions and maybe billions of people who do not believe that humans are going to come back. Allah tells us, قُلْ إِي وَرَبِّي لَتُبْعَثُنَّ. Say, O Muhammad, yes, by Allah, you will be resurrected. Don't let them have any doubt about this. So Allah is trying to protect us from our wrong-headed ideas, wrong-headed beliefs. Allah wants us to know Him by knowing His blessings and His gifts. Many brothers and sisters ask, how do I teach my children to love Allah? And the first response is, start by yourself. You love Allah and show them what do you do in your love of Allah. They will follow you. They will follow you. All of us humans, young and old, we love the ones who do us any favor, no matter how slight it may be. Even a smile, we appreciate it. At least most of us do. Right? Why do we fail to recognize the gifts and the blessings of Allah? Why do we fail to love Him back? يُحِبُّهُمْ. He starts by loving them. In fact, there are people who ask also, how do I know if Allah loves me? And they think that it is only when you count your bank account, right, that you know how much Allah loves you, how many dollars He gives you. But the dollars are of your making. You put the effort, you get some dollars. But Allah loved you before He had created you. So He gave you a companion who's made of the same material. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ اتَّقُوا رَبَّكُمْ الَّذِي خَلَقَكُمْ مِنْ نَفْسٍ وَاحِدَةٍ وَخَلَقَ مِنْهَا زَوْجَهَا وَبَثَّ مِنْهُمَا رِجَالًا كَثِيرًا وَنِسَاءً وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ الَّذِي تَسَاءَلُونَ بِهِ وَالْأَرْحَامِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ عَلَيْكُمْ رَقِيبًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us the best companions in our life, in our spouses, who are created from the same material, which is called an-nafs, nafs wahida, so that our desires revolve around one and the same thing. Our objectives, our needs, our wants, all of this, we are all humans. What makes us humans? Allah made us humans. So Allah, in His divine revelation, in the Quran, He keeps telling us about His blessings to us until He comes down and says, وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لا تحصوها. And if you try to count the blessings of Allah, you can never count it, let alone appreciate it, let alone offer gratitude for it. In fact, it also implies that if Allah wanted to count His blessings upon us, the Quran would have been unlimited, because His gifts are unlimited. So if the Quran is an exclusive book to just cite for us how many blessings Allah has given us, it would have taken billions and billions of pages. You could not carry it, you could not open it, you could not print it. So Allah counts some of His blessings that matter the most. His creation in heaven. وَجَعَلْنَا السَّمَاءَ سَقْفًا مَحْفُوظًا. We have made the heaven as a protective ceiling. Amazing. To protect us. You know how many billions of asteroids and debris that are running in the sky that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is taking away from our path. Last time I read, it was a huge asteroid that was scary. Everybody is writing, NASA and the Defense Department, and everybody is writing that it is going to get the Earth, and it may result in the split of the Earth if it hit any place. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took it just, you know, several miles away, and we are still here. Why? Why is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sending those debris around us and not on us? He could have done it. He wants us to notice His power and take lessons. Take lessons. It's a threat. It's something very dangerous. So Allah shows us His blessings. He shows us His protection. He shows us His love. He shows us His care. And He tells us, go and roam the horizon and the earth, and even roam inside yourself. سَنُرِيهِمْ آيَاتِنَا فِي الْآفَاقِ وَفِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَتَّى يَتَبَيَّنَ لَهُمْ أَنَّهُ الْحَقِّ. We will show them our signs, both in the horizons and in themselves, until they know that He is the truth. Allah هو الحق. وَأَنَّ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِهِ هُمْ هُوَ الْبَاطِلِ. Whatever we worship of any other thing or any other one, it is false, false gods. So one of the primary objectives of the Quran is to hook our heart to Allah, to show us that He is our life's center of gravity, that you cannot run away from Allah. Can the moon run away from the earth? Can the earth run away from the sun? كُلٌّ فِي فَلَكٍ يَسْبَحُونَ. Likewise, we cannot run away from Allah. We are tied to Him. Every one of us. Once we are created, we are all living on a string, a rope, between us and Allah. That string gets shorter and shorter and shorter and shorter and shorter every single day until it's finished. And then where do we go? We go back to Him. إِنَّ لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّ إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. We all belong to Allah, and we are all going back to Him. He is holding that string between Him and us, and He is controlling it. You can't run away. In the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to show us how much our rizq is connected to us, he says that إِنَّ الرِّزْقَ لَيَطْلُبُ أَحَدَكُمْ كَمَا يَطْلُبُهُ الْمَوْتِ. Can you run away from your death? The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم is saying that your rizq, your provision, runs after you to catch up with you every single day as death is running after you. We try not to die, which is okay. We must protect our life. But we must also know that there is an end. There is a point that we don't know. And part of the mercy of Allah is that He hid our end minute from us. If Allah were to tell us with a stamp somewhere, this person is dying in a month, this life would not be as safe as we have it today, even though it's terrible. Because we always do our homework at the last minute. So a person who lives 70 years and knows that he's dying after 70 years, he's not going to live a righteous life all along. He's going to be a righteous person, maybe a few weeks. I will make tawbah before I die. Because I know when I die, I know I have the time. But the reason Allah hid it from us is because we would not have been righteous with each other if we knew when we are going to die. So He hid this from us. Allah could have told us how much you're making in this life, but again, He hid this from us. And He told us, وَأَن لَيْسَ لِلْإِنسَانِ إِلَّا مَا سَعَى. Man only gets what man earns. You have to earn it to have it. So it is tied in your hand, but Allah has whatever total designated that He has for you, and you will get it. You will not die before you complete your rizq. You consume your last piece of bread and your last sip of water. لَن تَمُوتَ نَفْسٌ قَبْلَ أَن تَسْتَوْفِيَ رِزْقَهَا وَأَجَلَهَا. Your term has to be over, your provision has to finish. You will finish your provision before you die. So Allah secured our life, but He didn't tell us when to die. He secured our rizq, but He didn't tell us how much we're making. Why? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَوْ بَسَطَ اللَّهُ الرِّزْقَ لِعِبَادِهِ لَبَغَوْا فِي الْأَرْضِ. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala were to give people extended provision, they would have turned into tyrants against each other. وَلَكِنْ يُنَزِّلُ بِقَدَرٍ. But He gives it down with due measures. Everybody will get what you deserve in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah tells us in the Quran that He is the merciful, He is the compassionate, He is the one who created us, He is the one who created for us everything that we need to live a good life. And above all of this, out of abundance of mercy, He sent us prophets and messengers all over the ages to guide us and to help us understand how do we relate to Allah. What does Allah despise the most? Allah despises the most our association of partners with Him. Polytheism, ash-shirk. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ. And everything else is دُونَ ذَلِكَ. We think of filthy disobedience as worse than shirk. So we think of fahisha and zina and homosexuality, fornication, that they are very bad. But we do not get offended much by shirk. But Allah is offended most by shirk. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ. If anybody dies as a mushrik, he is sent to the punishment. He is not going to be forgiven. But Allah would forgive everything else. Even the mushrik, whose sin is the worst, still Allah tells them, إِيَّنْتَهُ يُغْفَرْ لَهُمْ مَا قَدْ سَلَفْ. قُلْ لِمَنْ فِي أَيْدِيكُمْ مِنَ الْأَسْرَى إِنْ يَعْلَمِ اللَّهُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ خَيْرًا يُؤْتِكُمْ خَيْرًا مِمَّا أُخِذَ مِنْكُمْ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ. Even the mushrik can be forgiven if he turns corner with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If they make a U-turn, if they repent and accept Islam and submit, they are going to be forgiven. With all the evil they have done, they made stone idols and they claim they are their gods. And Allah was still willing to forgive them if they repent. Not only that, but He puts it in the heart of the Prophet ﷺ when the angel of mountains come to him and tells him, Muhammad, Allah has authorized me If you want, I could crush all of these guys between these two mountains. And he says, no. Maybe Allah will bring from their own progeny, from their own descendants, someone who would worship Allah and associate none with him. What does Allah love the most? Allah loves the most those who love him. And the sign of love that Allah lists in the Quran is to follow his prophet, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So he tells his prophet, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهِ. Say, O Muhammad, if you truly love Allah, follow me, so that Allah would forgive you, would love you and forgive you your sin. So what is the sign of our love of Allah? Following the Prophet. In contrast, what is the sign that we don't love Allah? When we know his path and we choose to follow someone other than Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our heart for his love and fill our heart with his love. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وبعد. We are told in the Quran and in the Hadith, and we repeat it frequently in our prayer, that Allahu Akbar. It looks like a motto for Muslims. We always say Takbir, Allahu Akbar. But in reality, we do not treat Allah for the greater one he is. See, in Arabic, it doesn't say Allah al-Akbar. It says Allahu Akbar. Allah, out of tawaddud, out of endearment to us, he wants us to compare him to anything else and come to this conclusion that he is greater. So I have my business, I have my boss, I have to make money, but Allah says, فَذَرُوا الْبَيْعَ وَسْعَوْا إِلَى ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَذَرُوا الْبَيْعَ. Leave your business on Friday. A sign of our appreciation, a sign of our love, is that we come. We come to respond to his call. And we leave our business, which is very important. This is our livelihood. Why do we do this? Out of love and appreciation that Allah is greater than my boss. Allah is greater than my rizq. Allah is greater than all the pressure that life may put on me. Then we face lots of difficult situations in our life. If we appreciate Allah as Akbar, then nobody's hate or love will matter to us but Allah. Because we believe that Allahu Akbar, he is greater. I don't fear anybody as I fear Allah. I don't love anybody in competition with my love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So those are some of the elements that the Quran wants us to understand about Allah. To appreciate him, so that we can love him, so that we can live by his rules and live safely and live this life better than what we received it. This is the ultimate purpose. Allah wants us to be a better generation. Every generation should be a better generation. And the only way is to keep progressing in our love of Allah and to let our children inherit the love of Allah. We are more focused on shoving the rules of Allah to make our children obedient to Allah more than making them love Allah to obey him from their own internal sense of love. Not from our love for Allah, not from our love for our children, not from our love for their compliance and obedience. We all love to see our children praying. We all love to see our children memorizing the Quran, and we think that this is a good thing, which it is. But much more than this is, we should love to see them in love with Allah. Because then, when they know what He wants, they do it. So if you want your child to be a Muslim, one who submits on voluntary basis, not because you are pushing him, not because you are punishing him, not because you are going to do this or that to him, but because he loves Allah. How could he love Allah? Give him the reasons to love Allah. Tell him what Allah does for us every single day. Every breath we take in or out is by his blessings. Every time we put our head on the pillow to sleep, we are all in his hand. Whether to live the next day or not, it's up to him. Let your child remember to make his adhkar before he goes to bed. At least he protects himself from shayateen, from nightmares, all of this. So brothers, let us focus on appreciating Allah. Let us read the Quran to know who Allah really is, so that we love him and we appreciate him. اللهم اهدنا فيمن هديت وعافنا فيمن عافيت وتولنا فيمن توليت وقنا واصرف عنا شر ما قضيت اللهم اقسم لنا من خشيتك ما تحول به بيننا وبين معصيتك ومن طاعتك ما تبلغنا به جنتك ومن اليقين ما تهون به علينا مصائب الدنيا ومتعنا اللهم بأسماعنا وأبصارنا وقوتنا ما أحييتنا واجعله الوارث منا واجعل ثأرنا على من ظلمنا ولا تجعل مصيبتنا في ديننا ولا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا ولا مبلغ علمنا ولا إلى النار مصيرنا اللهم لا تجعل الآخرة إلا هي غايتنا ومثوانا يا رب العالمين اللهم اختم لنا بخاتمة السعادة أجمعين مع النبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم وأقم الصلاة